In Japan, the land of the rising sun, technology and tradition coexist in a unique manner. On one hand, life here is extremely ritualized. Ancient animist beliefs persist, and nature is still viewed today as a living entity, animated by spirit and having soul. On the other hand, the Japanese have assimilated and mastered Western science, technology, and business practices in a very short time, and are one of the most modern and prosperous nations. Japan is a small, densely populated country. This reality, shaped by the land, makes them acutely aware of the need for sustainable development. In 2005, Japan was host to the first World Expo of the 21st century. The Aichi Expo gathered many nations around the central theme of nature's wisdom. The exponential development of many countries has given rise to massive pollution. The problem has now reached the global scale. Three species disappear every hour. 1% of the tropical forest disappears every year. The world produces 500 million tons of toxic waste a year. 80% of wastes are not treated. Since the first World Expo in London in 1851, World Expos have continued to have considerable impact on the collective mind. For the last 150 years, they have been a showcase for art, industry, and the very latest technology.
The Expo in Osaka came at the peak of Japanese pollution. It was horrible. There were many days when there were smog warnings and children could not go out at recess to play. The schools kept them inside. It was rare that one saw Mount Fuji from Tokyo, even though it's only 70 miles away. From Kyoto on, you did not see the sun, even on a bright day. The Japanese arrived at a national consensus that something had to be done about pollution, and in subsequent years, very large percentages of their national product were used on pollution control. And of course, the air became much cleaner, the streams were cleaned up. Japan still has pollution problems, but this is a much, much different time than it was then.
The Osaka Expo's theme was progress and harmony for mankind. 35 years later, the Aichi Expo invites us to imagine a world where humans and technology coexist harmoniously with nature.
The biggest crime is to destroy nature. So you must be humble towards nature. This form of this pavilion, this looks like Mount Fuji, which is a symbol of Japan. And we want to have dreams towards the future.
This expo is good for people. Many people dream here.
Expo 2005 offers to the people of world an opportunity to come together and discuss the many global issues that face humankind.
Es una oportunidad única de conocer realmente lo que es un país, lo que tiene dentro y lo que son sus personas.
The good part of the expo, what it can bring to the people, is really the innovative part, so that people can see new products that help to save the nature.
Technological innovations can effectively answer some of our problems, but for permanent change to happen, we must also change our behavior. What relationship will we have with tomorrow's technology?
Die Japaner sind ja mit Robotern groß geworden. Für die ist Roboter etwas, was sie rettet. Oftmals Roboter, siehe Golem oder Metropolis, als Bedrohung gesehen haben. Die Japaner haben da einen ganz anderen Ansatz. Sie kennen Atomboy, die sind diese Manga-Figur oder andere Roboter, die sie retten. Und deswegen benutzen sie Roboter auch, um Zukunftsprobleme zu lösen. Die Japaner haben einen anderen Bezug zur Technik. Die Japaner versuchen, die Technik für ihre Nöte und auch Herausforderungen nutzbar zu machen.
Bei unserer Ausstellung unter dem Thema Top of Science haben wir auch einen Roboter, den Lokomat. Und der wird für querschnittgelähmte Leute. Es sollte ihnen helfen, wieder zu laufen. Und das tut endlich also die Arbeit eines Therapeuten erleichtern. Beziehungsweise kann man genau Geschwindigkeit und alles anpassen, wie das die Person sich muss bewegen muss. Sie kann laufen. Und mit dem, dass sie immer wieder läuft und trainiert, lernt sie so wieder zu gehen. Und das ist also für so medizinische Zwecke ist natürlich. Also das ist ein sehr schönes Beispiel von einem Roboter. Das ist ganz klar.
A new generation of automated wheelchairs is on the verge of being unveiled to the commercial market. People with reduced mobility will be able to benefit from artificial intelligence through the use of these automated wheelchairs.
The wheelchair will start. This car is currently being used for a demo course. We are developing it for 5 years as a commercial goal. But 5 years after its commercialization, shopping centers,病院、あるいは美術館といったような、お客様が場所は行きたい場所は分かるんだけど、経路が分からないといったようなところに対して導入をするのが5年後になるかというふうに考えております。一般の街の中で使うには、インフラの整備がかなり大変なので、そこまでの運用はまだまだ先になると思います。
Barrier-free, it is barrier-free. Papa aux personnes handicapées, ils font beaucoup d'efforts pour leur donner accès un peu à tous les bâtiments. Il n'y a jamais d'obstacles.
Hello, my name is Valdis.
This robot can learn. People in Lithuania who made this program every day receive information about questions or what people ask him. And for example, if the robot doesn't know the answer, they improve it. So every day it becomes more intelligent and intelligent. Yeah.
I am 5464556. I cannot say at the moment what Lithuanian process is.
Yes. Good night.
Robots are the top of science. But can they help us in solving environmental problems?
Do
Thanks to advanced teaching methods, the Japanese are cultivating awareness of the importance of reducing, reusing, and recycling at an early age.
This is a recycling quiz. We want all the people to know most of materials in the computer should be recycled. Actually, our company recycles 90% materials.
A world first, a PC with a large size body made from green plastic.
This is a plastic made from corn. We use extra corn that even animal can't eat. We made plastic from this cornstarch.
By introducing new high-tech recycling technologies and renewable energy sources, the Expo 2005 associations wanted the site to serve as a miniature replica of a real-world eco-community.
As industrialized and technologically based Japan is, it still has a very, very rich base of wisdom or culture that lives off of nature.
Much effort was made to implement environmental conservation measures at every step of the development of the Expo.
Das Thema ist ja Weisheit vor der Natur und zum Teil ist mir das recht suspekt, weil ich gehört habe, dass hier ein Naturerholungsgebiet eigentlich wäre. Und jetzt hat man da eine rechte Sache aufgebaut, die nachher wieder abgebaut wird. Und man hat das ein bisschen in die Natur eingegriffen.
On voulait que au maximum on puisse réutiliser tous les éléments. On a aussi le plus que possible mis des composants qui peuvent être recyclés.
As with the Canadian pavilion, many other pavilions here are of a modular nature and are easy to assemble, dismantle, and reuse. Toyota's pavilion was accordingly designed, constructed, and managed along these guidelines.
This main channel will be reused. That doesn't have any CO2 through the process.
Toyota, whose president is also chairman of the board of the Expo, planned months ahead of time for all the pavilion's electricity to be supplied by a windmill, and thus can claim that the energy used to power their pavilion produced no CO2 in the process.
There's great attention, of course, in the infrastructure of the Expo itself to environmental problems. What you walk upon is recycled material. The boardwalk, which constitutes the global loop, is made of untreated wood. There's great attention to all aspects of environmental preservation. Everything is recycled. The electrical power is supplied by a generator which feeds on garbage.
Visitors were asked to dispose of their garbage in 9 distinct containers. Goal: zero waste. Separated, garbage is a resource and a potential source of considerable energy. Nido's new energy power plant supplies the electricity for much of the Expo's infrastructure. Biogas from the fermentation of organic waste is transformed into hydrogen, which powers fuel cells.
A lot of the buildings here are actually powered by fuel cells, solar power. There's another power system where they take garbage and turn that into power. So all the garbage that gets thrown out here, take that and through some sort of process, turn it into energy.
An estimated 5 tons of waste produced each day on the site of the Expo was used to generate electricity.
この 泊の会場で半年間プラントを運転しますけれども、この経験をもとにこの設備全体をもっとそのシンプル化して日本の各地に普及させていくことが私どもの夢で。
This type of equipment consists of new energy sources that is a kind of environmental friendly one. So we are sure to have this kind of equipment all over the world.
Solar and wind power were also essential ingredients of a composite clean energy system implemented at the expo. New energies are starting to be used as individual means of power supply. Despite their modest popularity at the present time, they could well be able to efficiently furnish the planet with heat and electricity in the near future. A growing number of Japanese are installing solar energy systems in their homes, and the Japanese government highly encourages the continued development of photovoltaic technologies.
My grandparents' house, they use solar system de oyu wakashitemasu. They make hot water. More people are using solar system at their homes,
neighbors,
for their own energy source, so they can cut down on their electricity fee. If more people use solar system and probably get cheaper and cheaper, then more people would use for a new style of energy source at their homes. Yay!
They have new kind of solar power, which generates 30% more because it generates energy from both sides of the solar panel and also from the light that is reflected from the ground or from buildings or from the surroundings. And also wind power is a very good source of energy. Geothermal energy is very interesting, especially in areas like Japan or Iceland, where they have a lot of volcanic activity. They can pump water down, and it becomes steam, and it comes up, and they can use it to make power from turbines. It's no pollution at all.
Visitors were also introduced to the use of biomass plastic. Biomass refers to the renewable organic resources. The platters on which food was served, the plates as well as the glasses, were all made of biomass, a plastic derived from biodegradable corn-based resin. The other principal constituents of this plastic are clay and powdered seashells. Unlike other plastics derived from oil, these platters and glasses, once thrown out, will be decomposed into water and carbon dioxides by microorganisms in the soil. They will be converted into compost with the other raw wastes of the site and reused as fertilizer.
This is a bag of fertilizer. This is made from kitchen garbage of Fujitsu staff canteen. And this is very organic fertilizer, so it's good for plants, flowers to grow.
In agriculture, we use the not chemicals fertilizer, but like the fertilizer which goes from humans' manure.
The bio toilets on the site use the action of microorganisms to transform sewage water into clear, odorless, and reusable water. The organizers estimated a savings of around 10 million tons of water during the 6 months of the expo. To lower the temperature and humidify the surrounding air, a light mist is projected in many areas of the grounds. Abundant vegetation also helps to purify the atmosphere. the BioLung project makes use of rooftop and wall greening to mitigate the effects of global warming.
BioLung でございます。200種類以上の植物や花がこの150メートルの巨大な壁に植えられております。気温はおよそ2度から3度、周りの外気よりは低くなっております。夏は大変涼しく、環境にも優しい、プロムナードです。
The Growing Village is a project initiated by Canadian John Gathright. Visitors were invited to contemplate marvels of the forest in little huts built in the trees.This roof of sheet iron, coated with oxidized titanium, allows water to evaporate quickly, absorbing more ambient latent heat and reducing the temperature beneath the roof. Visitors received eco-money credits for buying ecological products.Refusing plastic bags and using certified low pollution transportation. This encouraged people to adopt responsible consumer habits. In Japan, as everywhere else in the world, transportation is a key issue. This roadbed.Is constituted of rubber chips made from recycled tires. These porous elastic road surfaces reduce traffic noise by 7 to 9 decibels. The multi-mode intelligent transport system is equipped with engines which run on compressed natural gas, a clean fuel.As trains, they are totally automated and need no driver, but they can also transform into buses and be driven on public thoroughfares. Powered by hydrogen fuel cells and a secondary battery, hybrid fuel cell buses are very clean and quiet. They emit no toxic substances, no carbon dioxide or nitrogen oxide.The only waste they create is water. Another form of clean, quiet transportation here were the Linamo trains. They were the first Japanese public use of magnetic levitation train technology.
I think this is the first time that the maglev technology has been used on a day-to-day, non-experimental basis to haul lots and lots of people. They may not be brand new technologies, but they're being used on a scale that perhaps is greater than experimental.
Ça fait longtemps que les Japonais ont pris des, ils ont les mesures les plus sévères du monde.En matière de pollution automobile. Tous les taxis sont obligés de rouler avec du gaz.
In Japan, all taxis and buses run on natural gas.
Comparativement, par exemple, à Paris, Tokyo est moins pollué. Ça fait longtemps qu'ils roulent au gaz, donc extrêmement peu polluante. Et les modèles qui vendent, ils ont très peu de diesel. Même s'il y a plus de gens, je sens moins la pollution à Tokyo qu'à Paris.L'atmosphère est assez polluée à Paris, ne serait-ce parce qu'on a des moteurs diesel en masse. Outre la pollution atmosphérique, ils rejettent des microparticules qui vont directement dans les poumons. Donc une augmentation des maladies respiratoires considérable ces deux dernières décennies. Là aussi, ça pose en plus des problèmes de santé des gens, de bien-être.
This right here is the GM concept hydrogen fuel cell car. It's called the Autonomy.
The only waste produced by these cars is water, and this technology can be adapted to any type of vehicle.
They've been using them all over Europe. I know FedEx and a lot of postal delivery services have started to use them. I'm not sure if it's made it out into the private sector, but a lot of commercial businesses have been starting to use them in government businesses. To get hydrogen into a liquid state, you have to cool it down a lot. And to do that, the process is very expensive. So finding an economical way is still in the works right now. So it'll start competing with gasoline car engines. Right now, they're still just a thought, because trying to get them to become economical and available to your everyday person is the next step.
Hydrogen is a clean energy, and many countries have started to use it, especially for public transportation. And the automotive industry continues to place high hopes in hydrogen-based technologies. Manufacturers today are closely following the evolution of ecologically friendly vehicles.
Qui a développé, le moteur s'arrête automatiquement dans les embouteillages. Il repart. Une fois qu'on roule. Et ça limite sensiblement la consommation. Maintenant, faut pas non plus se focaliser sur la consommation que des voitures. Je veux dire, on rentre maintenant sur la consommation des camions qui est problématique. Et là aussi, c'est des intérêts économiques difficiles à bousculer. Les transports routiers payent moins de taxes que les voitures particulières. Donc si on veut les inciter à utiliser par exemple un carburant plus propre, il faudra peut-être augmenter les taxes sur les carburants comme le gazole. Mais là on va se heurter à...
Currently, the global economy relies heavily on road transportation. Our range of possibilities as human beings has increased dramatically due to the freedom provided by personal mobility. Toyota has created the iUnit, a single passenger car. The iUnit is extremely compact and consumes very little energy.
The iUnit is very light, not too heavy. That's only 200 kilograms. Easy to move when turn right, turn left, easy to move.
At Expo, solid partnerships are created between nations. France and Japan have teamed up on projects promoting environmental respect and pollution reduction. The Toyota car manufacturing plant in Valenciennes, France, is one of the cleanest in Europe, with zero waste and little water consumption, as it possesses its own water treatment plant. The year is 2025. A Scandinavian transcontinental ship carries 10,000 cars, using only renewable energies and producing no harmful greenhouse gas emissions. Its power is supplied by wave, solar, wind energy, and fuel cell technology.
I think that in the future we will probably see that as the oil prices go higher and higher, people will on their own initiative start researching into more fuel efficient cars. At some point, somebody is going to realize that the future isn't oil. It's definitely something else. When oil gets too expensive, somebody is going to find other ways of producing energy. And that's the only force I think is strong enough to force through this evolution of the clean energies.
We are really dependent on gas, but Henry Ford, when he first developed the car, it was meant to run off of an ethanol engine, a grain alcohol engine, so every farmer could have a distillery in his backyard, brew his own gas, and run his own car, because he meant it to be a people's machine. And it's not as clean as hydrogen fuel, but it's a lot cleaner than regular gasoline fuel. Not to mention it comes from your renewable resource of, you know, grain alcohol, which is easy to produce.
Among all the currently available means of ecologically sound transport, public transportation remains the best choice. More than 22 million visitors came to Expo Aichi. People of all ages from all walks of life were able to take advantage of this event, thanks to environmentally friendly transportation networks.
We will soon be arriving at Westgate Station.
Many countries took advantage of this expo to share their culture and scientific knowledge, while trying their best to respect the theme of nature's wisdom. Three sub-themes were also proposed: nature's matrix, the art of life, and development for eco-communities. Germany merited the award for pavilion most respecting the theme, nature's wisdom. The pavilion showcased examples of bionic technology. Its theme, Bionis, is in itself a symbol that coexistence between technology and nature is possible.
Let's take an example for nature's wisdom. What you see here is the bone of an eagle. This bone, and if you cut it, it looks like that. And you see the eagle's bone, and you can construct this part, this unit, like an eagle's bone. And you have less material, less and less material, and you have less and less weight. Of course, less weight means less fuel, and less fuel means it's good for the environment.
An acoustic camera. You have a digital camera in the middle, and then on the ring we have 32 microphones. So it takes the sound, and it's usually used for sound reduction.
Some of the products here show how we can use bionic technology, for example, to reduce the sound.
The light beating motion of the propeller tips imitate the movement of an eagle's wing and allow for considerable sound reduction.
The outside of our pavilion is all artwork inspired by nature. On the inside, we've got installations which show science inspired by nature. This one is about learning from bats, the way that when bats move around, it's dark, they cannot see anything anyway, but they know because of vibrations, the sonar vibrations, what is near them. And a British company has developed, we called it an ultra cane, which is already on the market in the UK for blind people, and it helps them work out how big the objects are, what is coming towards them.
The Eden Project promotes sustainable development. Four separate areas under a single biosphere house tropical microclimates. It takes a lot of energy to maintain a biosphere, and this shape, inspired by a honeycomb, was deemed the most efficient. The Royal Botanic Gardens in Kew are collecting the vulnerable seeds of around 24,000 species of endangered plants and storing them in an underground freezer to keep them for the future. The children of Aichi were encouraged to participate in various projects. 10,000 children created huge mosaics representing plant life with recycled materials. In this manner, the children were made aware of the impact of human activity on all forms of life and the extinction of many species of plants and animals. The theme of Canada's pavilion was the wisdom of diversity.
On a réalisé en explorant notre thème qui était la diversité, que dans la nature, une partie de la sagesse dans la nature, c'est de garder la diversité.
Water is an essential component of life in all its various forms. Libya possesses the world's largest underground pipeline network, pumping water into the middle of the desert. This irrigation system supplies water to humans, livestock, and crops. More organic methods of farming preserve the natural habitat of many species as well as nature's biodiversity. One of the most frightening consequences of pollution is its negative impact on the food chain and the quality of edible goods. To reinstate agricultural techniques, which are in greater harmony with nature, fair trade is necessary.
Japan became such a biggest, you know, food importing country, but also we wasted so much food. So now we try to encourage many Japanese people to think about food and how we can preserve, and then also we need to share with other people in the world. So that's kind of a purpose of this pavilion. We have been focusing on technical advancement, but now we are realizing we need to focus on basic issues like food, health. That's basic that we always forget, but that's very important too. So we need to take a balance. That's what we believe.
Cooperation must now become the main focus of international relations.
I do think it's important to have a team, like people working together on protecting the planet. It's not only for us, but for our children as well.
It is very important to come together, all those countries, not only the rich countries, but also the still developing countries, the poor countries, and to have this kind of dialogue and to take a look at each other's ideas and solutions.
C'est la première fois dans une expo universelle que deux pays partagent le même pavillon. Alors évidemment, chaque pays expose dans une partie, la partie française et la partie allemande. Mais on a un tronçon commun au milieu qui est la maison commune sur le thème de la réconciliation franco-allemande de la fin de la Seconde Guerre mondiale jusqu'à maintenant. C'est vraiment l'espace franco-allemand. C'est un grand symbole, disons. En tout cas, c'est la première fois qu'on fait une telle coopération.
Cooperation is also fostered through the tireless activity of members of international organizations promoting humanitarian values that reach far beyond existing ideological frontiers. The Red Cross and Red Crescent have 183 local offices throughout the world today, with 100 million volunteer members. The organization has suggested a new religiously neutral logo, the Red Crystal. Humanitarian aid is a necessary, inevitable recourse for developing countries to be able to find the road towards sustainable development.
We've been talking about the Red Sea. We have to protect the sea because we have to live for our children. We always think for our children, for the future. We have got certain areas called as a national park. We have to keep it intact as it is. We don't invite mass tourism. We invite on ecotourism.
India, especially known for its rich spiritual and cultural heritage, has the second fastest growing economy in the world. Indira Gandhi once said, "Poverty is the biggest form of pollution." Our welfare is intimately linked to the overall health of our environment. By air, waterways, and other routes, pollution invades all nations and knows no borders. Environmental concerns are the most important issue of this day and age. An international agreement such as the Kyoto Protocol is essential for pollution reduction and to balance the effects of climate change.
This expo is held close to Kyoto, where the Kyoto Protocol was signed by almost everybody except the Americans.
The United States, I believe, was one of the initial pushers of the Kyoto Protocol, but then, you know, when the chips got down and when Bush came into office, just sort of backed out, which lost a lot of trust for the United States internationally. And other countries need to get behind the protocol, and countries need to be able to support America in making good environmental decisions, good international decisions.
Russia has joined the Kyoto Protocol, and the United States and China are not joining it yet, and by being the most polluting countries at the moment, I believe they are the one who has to think about it first and join as soon as possible, not only for the rest of the world, but for themselves as well.
Weisheit von Natur ist ein sehr wichtiges Thema, sicher ein sehr schönes Thema. Und gut in Japan auch, wo mit dem Kyoto-Protokoll in Verbindung gebracht wird. Und so ist das sicher auch, ja, es ist ein Thema, das nach Japan gehört und gleichzeitig ein internationales Thema.
Shanghai Expo is we want to have more than 200 countries, foreign countries, and international organizations to participate in 2010 Expo. Everything relates to the city, to the people's life in the city. I think more developing countries will be invited to participate in Shanghai Expo.
It's my hope that the Chinese will follow something of the same pattern that the Japanese did. Once the Japanese saw that they had indeed joined the developed world and that they had indeed become a rich country, they began to pay attention to their environmental problems and they attacked them in a very broad scale way.
Aichi 2005, it's a great opportunity for people to really know how important is the nature and how we have to be really care right now, because otherwise we will not have a chance again.
In In the mid-1960s, the New York Expo first showcased the microwave, and now it's an everyday household item. It's more than likely that we'll be seeing a lot of new green technologies in the near future.
Protecting environment is the biggest issue that we have living currently on Earth now.
Our planet is rich in resources, but for how long can it sustain this treatment? What we must remember about Expo Aichi is that great efforts were made towards a zero-waste objective, that clean and renewable energies were used on a broad scale, and that ecological transportation is no longer just a myth. In this era of massive changes in our ecosystem, scientific conclusions regarding the impact of human activity on all living species are irrefutable. Due to the urgency of all the challenges we are facing, respect for the environment must become our top priority. Only then can we perhaps alter the course of events in order to rediscover the wisdom of nature.